A very good evening and welcome to this edition of the Fourth Estate. Charles Mungu Shampagi, and tonight we'll be delving into a rather touchy subject, a narrow line to navigate between the sub judice rule of a matter before trial and also a very highly tribal, ethnically and tribally sensitive subject, the Matthew Kanyamunyu trial for the murder of Watmon Akena. We saw, or many people, many of our viewers saw, last week what turned out in court when the Matthew Kanyamunyu brothers, the Kanyamunyu brothers, Matthew and Joseph, appeared in court with Cynthia Munangwari applying for bail. With us to discuss this show tonight, let me first introduce Odonga Otto, the man who actually stoked the fires. Odonga Otto is a member of parliament. He represents Aru County in parliament on for the Forum for Democratic Change. He has indicated that he's been unhappy with the FDC. We'll discuss that detail later. We also have with us one of the aunties to the Kanyamunyu brothers, Marianne Sebunye. You're most welcome. We have with us FDC activist and former spokesperson, or deputy spokesperson.
I am the national spokesperson of the FDC Women's League.
National spokesperson of the FDC Women's League, Sarah Epero.
Good evening, viewers. Happy to be here.
Sarah, it's just a long time since you were last here.
Yeah.
That I'm never right to forget what you do for the FDC.
No, they keep changing. Yes. This post, I think I got early last year.
Mm-hmm.
Probably you haven't seen me since then,
mm-hmm.
So I don't blame you for not knowing my new appointment in the party.
And of course, my colleague, Onapito Ekomlite, Corporate Affairs Director of AB InBev, Niall Brewery.
Good evening, Charles, and good evening, viewers.
It's only 15 days into the new year, but it looks like the year is so old because the first 15 days have been such a roller coaster with so many things happening. We saw three announcements of reshuffle in the Uganda People's Defense Forces. Three separate letters communicating changes within the Uganda People's Defense Forces that saw the Chief of Defense Forces sent to government to be appointed as a minister, and we saw the removal of the commander of the Special Forces Command, Brigadier Muhoozi Kainerugaba, promoted to Major General, who now becomes a presidential advisor on special operations. We also have a discussion about the changes in the military later on in the discussion. Let me start with the discussion of the bail application. Number one to begin with is that Matthew Kanyamunyu and his brother and Cynthia Munangwari applied for bail. The bail wasn't granted when they appeared in court, but there was a storm over especially one touchy issue. A person chosen by the family to stand bail for Kanyamunyu. And that storm was started by Odonga Otto. Odonga Otto, you are a lawyer, you are a legislator. What exactly was your problem with engineer Honorable Winnie Byanyima appearing in court to stand surety for boys she considers her children?
Well, thank you so much, NTV, for this opportunity. It's true, I am an advocate. I practice law in chambers that are in my name. And I know bail is a constitutional right. Everyone is entitled to apply for bail because you are presumed to be innocent until proven guilty. There is no question about that. It's a question of law. And I was in court when the Kanyamunyus were applying for bail, and all the proceedings went on well.
Mm.
But what was very disturbing that brought emotional outrage was the fact that Honorable Engineer Winnie Byanyima, International Director, Oxfam, the wife to FDC Party President, Dr. Kizza Besigye, could choose to stand with the accused. That was very disturbing to me as a member of FDC.
Why?
You know, as I posted earlier, legally she has a right, but politically and morally, it was wrong timing. It was a slap in the face of many of us who extensively mobilized for Besigye in the North. We've lost so many lives because of Dr. Besigye. So I personally do not object. Even if it were Edith Byanyima, I would have no problem with that. Honorable Captain Gard was in court. We don't have any problem with that. At least they should have saved the face of the party. They saved the face of the first lady in FDC to appear on the side of the aggressor in such a sensitive matter. That is where we're crying foul.
When you say the side of the aggressor, Honorable Otto, you are breaching one of the principles of presumption of innocence.
Yeah,
we do not know yet, at the moment, who killed Kenneth Watmon Akena. There is a suspect, there are suspects in court, but we do not know.
Yeah, the point I'm putting and I'm emphasizing, it is in bad taste for Honorable Engineer Winnie Byanyima to come and stand surety. That is my opinion.
Mm.
And there are many of precedents in our jurisdiction. When Agaba was in, the late Agaba was in court, she's closely related to the First Lady. Why didn't the wife of the President, Janet Kataha Museveni, come to stand surety for her? There are certain things, if you are at the high echelons of the society, you really need to test your actions before you show up. So if Winnie Byanyima had not shown up, appeared in court as a surety, we would not have complaints. They can line up even 1,000 people from any parts of the country.
You said on camera,
yes,
that group interests assault when individuals feel weak against the mighty, only time will tell. And you said the political lines have been redrawn.
Precisely.
What exactly do you mean?
Let me reiterate here. I'm glad Madame Sarah is here. The implication of Winnie Byanyima's appearing in court has politically hit FDC very hard. I've made a statement and I want to make it now. I'm giving notice. I've given notice to FDC. Not me alone, myself, Honorable Yet Simon, Honorable Olanya Gilbert, Honorable Achiero Lusu Tim, that come 2021, we are quitting the FDC party.
Mm.
Because we feel probably Honorable Winnie Byanyima on arrival from abroad, she should have even gone to Kitgum to condole with the family, to sit with Akena's family, to say we are sorry for what happened. But to appear in the country and jump on in court in the side of the suspect, it did not augur very well with us.
If roles were reversed, what would you have done?
Pardon?
If roles were reversed, how would you have reacted?
What do you mean roles reversed?
If you were the relative of Kanyamunyu,
you see,
would you stand with him?
I've just made it clear, we did not cry foul for Edith Byanyima standing surety. We did not cry foul for God standing surety. We are crying foul. Even if you check on the social media page of Winnie, she says justice and compassion for the oppressed. We feel for such a high profile international figure to appear in such a case, no matter the degree of blood relationship, we felt that was unnecessary. And for your information, I talked to Dr. Kisa Besigye about this.
Mm-hmm.
He personally called me when Akena had just been killed. He called me 2 days after that and he said, Honorable Otto, my wife Winnie Byanyima has called me requesting that if we can sit and mitigate on these issues, that his wife Byanyima was called by Edith Byanyima. So he was trying to ask me if we could reach out to the family. And I told him my mind.
Mm.
Even a day before bail application, I was in Serena. I advised the Byanyima family that please cancel that bail application. It is bad timing. It is in bad taste. The societies are still sensitive. The moods are still not good. I told them a day before. And for your information, let me be on record before the aunt comes. I have expressed instructions from the father of Akena. He called me 30 minutes before this show. That we as Acholis, we are very rich in reconciliation. We have what we call matter of foot. Akena has died. Akena will not resurrect. We can reconcile with the Kanyamunyu family. However, reconciliation is based on a confession. You don't reconcile with impunity. You don't reconcile with impunity.
Honorable Thor, you are the lawyer on this show. The rest of us are not. So you understand the sub judice role better than all of us, I would presume. So I would imagine that you wouldn't go into the merits of or demerits of the case at this stage. But we'll come to discuss your politics and in relation to this matter and the tribal dose that has been infused into them since the discussion began. We couldn't get Honorable Winnie Byanyima on the show, but we have an auntie to the Kanyamunyus, Marianne. The discussion, like Odonga Otto says, it's not about the rights to bail. It's about the political sensitivity of a person who has a profile as big as the Honorable Engineer Winnie Byanyima, deciding to stand out when the rest of you could have come in. What was the motivation? Did you have a discussion on the profile of the person who stands surety?
Okay. Thank you. If you don't mind, may I take this opportunity, first of all, to reach out to the family of Akena and express our condolences from the wider family of the Kanyamunyus, because when it happened, I was up country, and when they called me, the first reaction was, how do we reach out to the family of Akena? How can we express our condolences? Who can we go through? And I was told it's not the right timing. And not long after that, the tribal sentiments came in, and that was put on hold until this comes out. We get over this. So thank you, NTV, and I was happy to come here to, first and foremost, express our condolences. It's very sad that a life was lost. It's very sad that the way things are looking doesn't look like Matthew will be given an opportunity to say what happened. He has made a statement. Things went out in the papers. And everything he has said up to now has not, no attention has been paid to it.
Mm.
For example, I know that he said there were two people.
Can I warn that we need to be careful not to go into the merits of the case, because
it's not the merit.
The statement is made before investigators and the prosecution is a matter for the prosecution to look into and the lawyers to look into.
Okay, I'll stop there. But all in all, in summary, I am praying and hoping that Matthew will get fair hearing, will get justice. When we talk about justice, we cannot say justice for Akena. We want justice for all, Akena and Matthew. So what motivated us, going back to your question, what motivated us to ask Winnie to be one of the sureties was because when we talk to the boys, who do you propose to stand surety for you, they came up with a list of friends.
Mm.
And as a family, we looked at the list of friends and we said, it's not fair on your friends to load them with this burden of making sure you stay in the country, you attend court when you are supposed to. And we thought, who else can ensure this more than the family, more than the parents? Winnie's one of the parents of these boys. They were five boys. They were left all of us, all right. But Joseph in particular, and Matthew, both of them were Winnie's children.
Mm.
And when you talk about her stature, her role in society, her internationally and nationally, who else would the courts respect more than Winnie to ensure these people come back for trial?
There is the question of the family ties. There is the question of the moral and social responsibility.
Mm.
There is also the question of the politics that Winnie has represented. Did you have a discussion about that? Did you think through that? That caused a storm like it has caused?
Unfortunately, Winnie was not in the country when we took the decision as a family to ensure that it's only parents that will stand surety for these people. If you look at the whole list, including Gad Gasatra, is one of the Captain Gad Gasatra is one of the guardians. I think when by the time she came in, it was a bit late for her to say no, because we had not thought of anybody else. I was the spare one, but just like 2 days before application, I was hospitalized. So even if she wanted to say no at that moment, I think the documents that were ready were either me or her. So since I was in hospital, she had
How has she since reacted to the political fallout after her appearance in court?
I haven't talked to her, I'm afraid.
You haven't had a discussion that
I haven't had.
You presented the list of sureties and
I fell sick. I was hospitalized. When I was discharged, I went for further treatment in Nairobi. So I haven't met Winnie, I haven't called her, haven't had a discussion with her, maybe.
Sarah, you responded
Honorable Dongoto could have discussed with
you. You responded to a Facebook post by Honorable Odongoto after that court incident. Could you go back to that a little bit? And you had completely divergent opinions from what he shared.
Yeah, first of all, like Auntie has done, I would like to send my condolences to the family of Kenneth Akena upon this the loss of such an active person. But he's not the only Ugandan that has died. He's not the only Acholi. Can I also send my condolences to all the Acholi that have been killed, especially the regime, and whose best friend Dongoto has become of late. I would like to send condolences to my people in Kasese that were butchered recently, and I thought I would find people like the Otos also crying in courts recently in Jinja to show their displeasure about that kind of occurrences. Winnie Byanyima, before she came into FDC, had a family, just like Otto does, just like everybody like you. Even Ban Ki-moon has a family. Because I saw Odongoto was saying, no, we should take to Oxfam to put her right. Everybody of us first has the first relationship with the family. Then you relate to FDC. And in my party, there's no clause anywhere in our constitution that says that once you are in FDC, you do not have to have relatives. This is not the first time Winnie is standing surety for somebody on a murder charge. I hope you remember some time back, Winnie stood in for Honorable Regan Okumu and Honorable Michael Chula. They had murder charges on them. I never saw any Otto, any Anywar, any Ohulanya go to Obongmin's family, the chairman that had been allegedly murdered by Okumu and Ochula. I never saw them go to mobilize them and say, why is Winnie, a very highly placed person, coming to stand in surety for Okumu and Regan? Then she was and Michael. Then she was very, very right. Now comes to Kennedy's case. Like Auntie has said, these are kids Winnie has brought up. When she goes to stand in surety for them, also on murder charges, she's the wrong girl, she's extremely bad, she shouldn't have done that, she should look at her morals.
Hold a moment.
So I do not like these double standards that Dongoto is trying to put forward.
To outsiders, Sarah, to outsiders, myself, Honor here, and I believe Auntie, what the outburst, the exchanges that have been, we have been reading on social media especially, shows a deeply fractured political party. And that both
FDC?
Camps. Yes, that both camps.
Which camps?
The one that Odongaoto represents and the side that we represent are just taking advantage of victims of a victim, who in this case is Kenneth Watmon Akena, may his soul rest in peace, to just bring him to the fore problems within your party.
That is where my problem is. I got extremely disgusted by his actions because he was trying to politicize the death of Akena, which is very wrong. I was disgusted on seeing him bringing FDC party and bringing Dr. Kizza Besigye. I've been to Padel with Odongoto, with Dr. Kizza Besigye. We slept in your hotel. We've been there campaigning many times. He was a darling. Now, what has happened of late? Must everybody answer on the wrongs for the wrongs spouse has done? So it was extremely disheartening to see that Odongoto was trying. First of all, they tried to bring the tribal sentiments. Me, I come from Teso, Odongoto. Kwon killed people in my home, in Teso sub-region. But not even once did I say the Acholis are bad. We said Kwon killed our people. We never tribalized it. We never said you don't want Acholi in Teso sub-region. We took it as it came. So for one person to try to tribalize a death to gain political capital is extremely disheartening. Extremely disheartening. So, and on one side, Auntie has not tried to tell you to the end. I have spoken to Winnie. I was with Hamas on Thursday. And she told me exactly what happened. She came in as last resort. This is a matter charge which involves two people who are nationals and one who is a foreigner. Many people were extremely reluctant to stand in for the foreigner. So it's the family that gave in and said, let us do it. Mm-hmm. So she came really as last resort. She was not even supposed to be in the team. Mm-hmm. So because there was nobody willing, you know what a murder charge is in this country, and involving a foreigner, nobody was willing. So Winnie said, at last resort, let me come in. These are my kids. I've been their mother. I cannot let them down at the last minute, like every other person would do to relatives, even Odongoto. So I was extremely disappointed when I saw my brother crying, real crocodile tears. I said, is this the lawyer Otto I've been respecting? And the good thing is, he shot himself in the foot. First he said, yeah, I'm a lawyer, he has right. Then what? Does the law say you should choose who should stand in or who shouldn't? So it is Winnie's right to stand in surety for her children. Those who saw it, who want to politicize it.
You'll have your time.
First of all, Winnie went to court as herself, as an individual. She never went as FDC, just like Otto went to court as Otto, not as FDC. Nobody deployed him there. He's not a party lawyer when he was in court then. So for him to really, really start making such outbursts, saying I'm leaving the party, we are in a multi-party dispensation. In a multi-party dispensation, you are free to switch parties any time of the day, morning or midnight. So whoever feels they should stay in FDC, good, we shall continue with them. Whoever thinks for their own reasons should go to any other party, we shall say, good, it's your decision.
Okay.
Many people have left.
Thank you.
But FDC has stayed.
So
for Odongoto to use Akena's death to gain political capital, reaching an extent to say, no, this Besigye, if he has to come to Acholi sub-region, he has to come in Anamadika. Excuse me, Mr. Otto. Mr. Museveni has killed so many Acholi there. But when your father died, you were just holding his hand like this. Why didn't you tell him that now so many millions of Acholi have died for the last 20 years? Come in an armored car. Who has Dr. Besigye killed? Why do you want to politicize such things? I'm disappointed in you.
We don't know who Mr. Mseven has killed. You're making
his
an
regime.
We
his regime. You know, in a regime, he takes credit or he takes
least
blame.
When I worked for him, I did not know him to kill people.
It's his army.
Honor, let me bring you to this discussion.
Yes.
The critical question here is that from November 12th, when Kenneth was killed, the very first post that came out had a tribal element to them. Two questions to you. What does this say about the healing process of this country? And two, is it like some people have said that Honorable Odongoto and his friends are trying to make political capital out of a tribal thing by rallying tribal sentiment?
Charles, this is a very sensitive issue, as you can see around the table. And fortunately, we have authorities on the matter and they are speaking. So I wouldn't pretend really have much more authority. So I wanted to dodge your question a little and go to what, in my view, this also exposes. It's the issue of the complexity, sometimes almost unnecessary, in the court process, whereby the court, like most places in Uganda, sadly, is becoming a place of whom do you know? You know, I see most of the time when cases come up, some people are denied bail because the sureties are not substantive and this kind of stuff. So there is now a tendency to line up big guns. It's not just only in this case. Whom do you know, sort of? So I think the courts need to learn from this that maybe to avoid this kind of situation where I have to bring big guns from abroad, they should really allow for other people who may not be substantive, but who are Ugandans, who have a job, who have address, to be sureties. I see this is not a unique case where you're having a lineup of sureties who are said to be substantive. And I suspect the Kanyamunyus got caught up in this kind of thinking, that if you take in people who are known, then maybe
you have a higher chance.
You have a higher chance of being listened to. And I think that shouldn't be the case, because it means if you're a small person in the country, you don't know who is who, then your chances of getting bail are always minimal. When it comes to the issue of sort of the tribalizing of this case, I'm not surprised. I mean, this is a highly tribal country, with all due respect. And people want to try and pretend that we're not a tribal country. But in many cases, especially when death occurs, there's a lot of rallying around the tribe. You know, even if you go to any typical funeral across Uganda, it's really a parade of who is who from that part of the country in terms of people who are in government, who are in private sector. So sometimes you excuse people for tending to flock together with the birds of a feather. And I don't see anything terribly wrong with that. But the political interpretation, maybe it's a bit, it's overboard, I would say. Because I don't know whether Kenna was an FDC player, I mean, supporter, I'm not sure.
Whether
the Kanyamunyus are NRM people, I don't know. So I think there's a lot of, but emotions are raw, and maybe you can understand where Honorable Talk comes from.
You've been itching to come in, especially to Sarah's comments. But the question is, this is your third time in Parliament, isn't it?
Fourth
time in Parliament. You're a national leader. So, are you concerned by the dose of tribal sentiment that you have personally infused into this discussion?
Let me tell you, if I may first regurgitate on what Sarah said, FDC is fighting for its political survival. We have made a decision to quit. It's a matter of time. You just wait and see the percentage FDC will get in Northern Uganda. Just wait and see. We are not going to argue about this. The demobilization process has started. So the opinion being expressed by Sarah to save the life of FDC, it's late. The cat is already out of the bag. And she goes ahead to say Winnie stood surety for Honorable Uchula and Honorable Regan, trying to say why is it wrong for Winnie to stand surety for Kanyamunyu. Let me tell you, the case against Honorable Regan, Honorable Uchula, even Dr. Kizza Besigye, were trumped up charges, politically motivated cases, including that rape case. These were active politicians, sitting MPs, that the government wanted to pull down politically. So they put cases on them. It is not a normal case like where someone is in a shopping mall in Lugogo and then another person dies because your car has been scratched. They are totally different cases. In any case, Winnie Byanyima was arrested while she was still in active politics. She was at Kira Road Police Station. I was the first to go there with Honorable Kupa Elijah. Honorable Kupa Elijah stood surety for Winnie Byanyima. Where was Kanyamunyu? Is Kanyamunyu a member of FDC? Is this a political case? So the point I'm saying, if you people don't see anything wrong with Winnie Byanyima appearing to SS Kanyamunyu surety, that is political. We shall sort it out politically. The lines have been drawn. But the point I need to emphasize, I came to this studio very happy. At least now I know why Akena was killed. Because one of the family members, Edith Byanyima, said Kanyamunyu's father was killed by Amin's regime. And they allege it is Acholi. So they are trying to say it is payback time.
I think that's the interpretation. Hold it a moment. I think what I have heard from the relatives of and friends of Kanyamunyu is that he grew up an orphan. His father died in politically charged times.
Yeah.
How you transfer that to payback time is something I don't understand. And the other question is, let's go back to the question of FDC. Where does FDC come into this discussion?
If I may develop that point. Because if people... I was born in 1977, 2 years before Amin was removed from power. The single biggest tribe that were massively killed by Amin soldiers were Acholis. So for someone to start alluding that so-and-so lost a father during a means of gene, that is exactly what is tribal. That is what you should castigate as being tribal. That is a tribal overtone from Winnie Byanyima. My reaction to that is not tribal per se. Let me also say this, which is very important.
There is a litany, Honorable Donga Otto,
yes,
of Facebook and other social media posts,
yes,
that you have put out that speak nothing but tribe.
Hmm.
You see,
that speak nothing.
The general feeling down there is, these are well-positioned people in the society who think they can use their influence to walk away with murder. This is the general feeling down there.
Then what is she,
please hold on, you had your time. Please hold on. Now, for someone to say, let people come in buses from Gulu and we see if they go back. These are serious statements which we are taking up with you, with Uganda Police. But the point I want to say is, if Akena does not get justice, this society will be fractured. This is a fact. And let me tell you without shame, yesterday I was at Kera Road Police Station. They are still even asking my tribe. We are a country of different tribes, and we should recognize we are different, but we should learn to live together.
But
now, you say I want political capital.
Yes.
I won 4 elections even before Akena was killed. Which political capital did I need from the death of Akena? I don't understand. 4 elections. 4 successive elections, even when Akena was still alive. So which political capital do we want?
There is a question, Honorable Donga Otto. Are you providing leadership or fanning sentiment? There's that critical question for you.
Let me tell you, the general feeling out there, which you need to listen to carefully, and let me say this while smiling, that there are people who have positioned themselves in this society that they can do wrong things and walk away with it. That is the general feeling across the line. If you are not comfortable listening to it, I'm sorry for you. There is a general feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And we as leaders should do something to show that this society, we can still live together even when we are separated.
Are you doing that by what you have, your public statements on formal and social media, or ordinary and social media?
I just stated at the beginning of the show that I have expressed instructions. If these things are reaching this level of tension between Acholi and Banyankole or what, it is not worth it. The society is getting fractured because people want justice. I stated at the beginning of the show, and I've been approached by the Kanyamunyu family, by the, let me now make this on air, that they're willing to reconcile. So I stated that, and I have expressed instructions from the father of Akena, who is even looking at me now, that they want to know how their son died. There has to be a confession.
There has to be an admission. The court process is supposed to do that.
Yes. No.
Mm.
The moment parties agree, we can ask the jurisdiction of court.
No. As a lawyer,
yes,
with a matter before court, I thought that is a process. If you needed to, if there was, as you say, either confession or something, you would apply to the judge and say, we want to take this matter out and have it resolved elsewhere.
No, what I'm
but
saying, yeah.
Just hold it a moment. You are the lawyer on the show, the rest of us are not. Criminal prosecution in this country is a matter between the state and the accused. So it's not a negotiation between families that would resolve a criminal matter.
Where is Desh?
Yeah?
Where is Desh of Paramera Garden?
He's being tried, isn't he?
All right, let's use that. But the point I'm saying, I came deliberately on this talk show to extend an olive branch.
Mm-hmm.
Because many people perceive our responses to be tribal. The same way we perceive Winnie Byanyima's appearance and Edith Byanyima's response to be tribal.
Okay.
It's two-way. It takes two to tangle. But the point I'm saying is this. The point I'm saying is this, which I would beg you just to give me a second to say that. We want justice for Akena. We don't want people to show up because they are well-positioned, they are in Oxfam, they are international people, they have all the money. Let me tell you, of all the 35 million Ugandans, no one eats in anyone's home. For me, I eat millet and posho. I don't even know how to eat a shabwe.
Okay.
So we should know we are different, and we must respect ourselves.
Okay.
I am not tribalistic. I employ 103 Ugandans. Out of them, 16 are Banyankole. Even my top manager, Nathan, in my casino is Banyankole. If I were tribalistic, I would fire them. I'm not. No one should bring tribal overtones.
We
want justice.
Yes, I have. When a lawyer is looking for justice, a political leader is looking for justice, but assumes there is only one victim at the moment, it can be a bit problematic. And the second thing is, we do not know when we're speaking to top people, well-positioned people, a member of parliament who's been in parliament for 4 terms is, by all means, a very important person. So if you're standing on one side, there are 2 important people on one side.
Yeah.
But you wanted to respond before you take a break. You wanted to make a comment before you take a break.
No, I know it's not, but even to make a record, yeah. Someone complained, it is Byanyima complained, that the police officer investigating the case is an Acholi. Well, Ali, not an Acholi, he's a Langi. And in any case, he reports to Kampala Extra Metropolitan Police, who is from Western Uganda. So people should not bring tribal sentiments to favor them.
Thank you.
They should not bring
we need to take a quick break. I think we have overrun this segment. Let's take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll continue this discussion. I warned at the beginning of the show that this is walking a very thin line, walking on eggshells, as Honor Peter put it. But let me just seek some feedback from some of our viewers. Someone says, let Honorable Otto know that reconciliation doesn't amount to withdrawal of the case. It's only the state through the Director of Public Prosecutions that has powers to withdraw a criminal case. Justice takes precedence over anything else. To try to link someone's criminal liability to their political affiliation is extrajudicial. That's from Jose Nwabine. I believe he's in Kabola Liantonde. Another listener, a viewer here, Nteji Asimwe, says, Honorable Dongoto, would it be right for Joseph Kony's relatives to stand surety for him if he appeared in court one day? Would it be right?
I like such an interesting post. You see, Winnie Byanyima, whom I respect so much, is a wife to someone who should have been the president of Uganda.
Mm.
She's high profile. If you cannot understand this point, I cannot explain it any better. She's a high profile person. Actually, her appearance as Kanyamunyu's surety, even President Museveni should have smiled. Because it sent a very wrong signal into northern Uganda as to what kind of party FDC is. It sent a very wrong signal.
Look, for me, to disagree, if it sent, even if I agreed with you, you should say it sent the wrong signal to the whole of Uganda.
Yes.
That maybe FDC leaders do not condone
not
even appearance of crime. But now for it says northern Uganda.
No, well, it could be an overstatement.
Hmm?
Mm.
You see, Charles, to go for a campaign to say people should vote for Dr. Besigye in 2021 would be fairly difficult. Because people will say, well, when we were mourning our son, the wife did not come. We lost people like James Opoka, who were killed because they were doing political activities. So for us, we are saying, we wish Besigye well. I respect him so much. He's my friend. He appointed me even chairperson of a committee in parliament during when he was party president. But we are saying this is a point of departure. And please, Sarah, respect our opinions. If we say we are leaving FDC, we are leaving. For
okay.
You have
but
not even
no.
You have even failed to be an LC1 in your village.
Who has said
you
don't
can't
go.
Win an election.
Who has said don't go?
So
that's exactly what I've said, that you're free to go in
yes.
or come back at
but
any time.
But the point
you
I'm
like.
Saying, if you are saying there is nothing wrong with Winnie Byanyima appearing as
purity,
it's okay. The rest is a political problem.
Let's have first Marianne come in here.
Yeah.
You listened to Otto, because I think much of the discussion on that part of the discussion of the subject is what he has said in relation to your relatives who are in prison.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could respond.
I wanted to respond on Winnie not being sensitive. I think actually on the 12th when it happened, I'm not on Facebook, but I know that Winnie sent a message. I can't know what social media. It was sent to me via WhatsApp, but cut from somewhere. And she said her heart and thoughts went to the family, and she sent her condolences. So when you say that she's not sensitive, she did not say sorry to the family, I don't understand where you are coming from.
That one aside, Charles. Odongoto has brought some fears that big people are going to interfere with the case. He should not say that now. Most especially when, by the time Winnie tried to stand in surety, they did not grant the bail. That one shows that she does not have the capacity to either influence or interfere with the court process. She merely came in to stand in for...
The bigger question that Odongoto has been raising is... the profile of Winnie Byanyima in relation to her politics.
That is one, not have to have rights because of profile?
Mm.
Really, really? That because you are Ban Ki-moon, you don't have to have relatives? That one is looking at it from the wrong side of the coin.
If I may ask.
That one aside, Odongo Toa said, which political capital are they trying to gain out of this? You know what is happening now. The only thing that is keeping the regime on its toes is our campaign of defiance, is Dr. Kizza Besigye. And they will love to hear anybody who will come out with a statement that will appear to weaken his position in public. Recently, you heard what Nabila said. You've already heard what my friend Katutu has said about Dr. Kizza Besigye. So this one is additional. How does really a normal person, and in that, in this matter, a lawyer, bring in the name of Dr. Besigye in a case where
like I said at the beginning, we are seeing an explosion, or a public explosion of internal problems within the FDC. I mean, if you have two FDC people, Odongo Otto, Winnie Byanyima, exchanging in public, and we have seen the
they
social media
exchanging
comments,
on their personal status, not as part officials. That is not what FDC stands for. If you go out as a person and do whatever you want. For example, if I became a night dancer today and they caught me night dancing, would they say FDC is a party for night dancers? I'll have done that in my personal capacity. So I'm extremely disturbed when Odongo Otto thinks he can intimidate Sarah Perry on this show by saying I can't win an LC election. You're wasting time. Facts are that what the outbursts that you really created in court, the crocodile tears, the actions, and so the meaning of a lawyer like you. I used to have a lot of respect in you because I knew you have trained there and you'd stand in for us as a party. But now, Odongo Otto, that one was so disastrous in your personal capacity.
Hold it for a moment. Your family, you're trying to get justice for the Kanyamunyu, and they deserve that justice. They deserve a fair hearing in court, like you said at the beginning. But the I do not know how this the events over the last few days have impacted on you as a family, on your preparations to provide defense, to provide support to your relatives.
We are worried. I'm sick. I told you I have been in hospital. I'm a mother. I feel like a mother to those boys. We are worried that these boys will not get justice.
And Akena also has a mother, and Akena is ready in the grave. At least for you, you are in prison. Akena is
if
ready.
If you can allow me, I allowed you to talk.
So everyone has mothers.
No, I allowed you to talk, and I came here, weak as I am, just because I saw an opportunity, first of all, to express our condolences, and secondly, to find out from Honorable Odongo Otto whether or to find out what he's trying to achieve, to intimidate the courts, to, if you are looking for justice, why do you call it justice for Akena? Can justice be one-sided? Justice is justice. Let's go out there, look for justice for both. Because when we look for justice for both, I believe the guilty will be convicted, and the family of Akena will feel Akena has so when we talk about justice, let's not talk for one side. I think I just wanted to find out if there is anything our family can do, if we can cooperate to get justice for both, then let's do it. But to say that justice for Akena is one-sided, and it's not justice anymore.
To me, again, I want to turn these tables on the system that is trying to deliver justice in this country, starting from the police. The problem with cases like this started all the way from the beginning, the lag of period between arrests and appearance in court, and then creating the impression that there is some hidden hands that is trying to either protect the suspects or what. And this is really a lesson for the police. Because now you're having all these tribal sentiments being injected into a case which really should be a pure criminal matter. But I think the old thing has been handled in such a protracted manner that it's now truly political. Unfortunately, it's become political when it shouldn't be.
Very political.
Mm. And I want to agree with him. It's not focusing on the crime. Mm. It's focusing on the tribe and the party.
Yes.
We've gone off track, in my opinion. Let's concentrate on a crime committed, if it was committed by the Kanyamunyus or somebody else. Let's concentrate on the crime, who committed the crime, and not what tribe they are.
Mm.
And when you look at from the beginning, when I say we are worried, is right from the beginning, Matthew is presumed guilty until he proves himself innocent, instead of the other way around. That's my worry, that's the family worry. And when Honorable Odonga Otto, when we have our leaders, a member of parliament that is seeing things going wrong, and he has so many fora in which to address these things, and he chooses to go to court and take the fight in court, and that's where I ask him, what are we trying to achieve by causing chaos in court? Is it to intimidate the judges? Is it to intimidate the family of Kanyamunyu, for example, not come to NTV? Today I said, sick or not, I'll be in this studio, because we have allowed, and we discussed it, we allowed 2 months of quiet to allow Akena's family to mourn him and finish. So, Mr. Odonga, where will this, how long will you carry this forward? Are you giving consolation to the family of Akena, or you are,
fueling?
Fueling.
I was in court. Mm. The state requested that investigation in Akena's case. They need 10 days before they can commute him for trial. They said that they just need 10 days. The file is complete. And it is not a coincidence that when it is remaining 10 days for commutation, that is when they want this man to apply for bail. Why? 10 days is not much. Actually, in the next appearance in court on Tuesday, if they commit him for trial, I would even be saying, all right, let him now come out. The file is ready. We don't want a situation where people want to use their influence to come out before the file is complete and they start plucking certain pages. You saw even the check they issued in my name.
Let me ask a question to just add to what. You hold an important public position. And for all intents and purposes, you have tried to use your influence to direct public discussion on this case from day one. And she asked you a question. What do you mean when you say you need justice? Are you presuming that the suspects in court are guilty until they prove themselves innocent, or you allow the court to go through that process?
Mm.
You see, in law, there is what we call strict liability offenses. Like when the police gets you and say, give us your permit. If you don't have it, you don't have to go through a trial, because you just don't have the permit.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, what, in response to my good mom's question here, what we are saying, we are not saying we don't want a fair trial for Kanyamunyu. No. What we are saying is we don't want that trial to be influenced by people who are well-networked in the society. That is all what we say.
Do you take your own role, your own comments, as trying to influence the trial?
No, you see, it's like we are on a weighing scale. I am on the side of the victim. And if anything is not going on well with the investigation, I must cry foul. For example, we made a request that we want to meet the DPP before the file is committed, because we wanted to check the holes, if there are any, in the prosecution. Ma'am, the point I'm saying, you have a right to stand for your son. Mm. We are not going to obstruct that.
Mm.
Actually, in the next bail application, if Kanyamunyu appears in court when the file has already been committed for trial, that is up to court to decide. But you have a right to stand for your son. I know how you feel. I know how Winnie Byanyima feels. But what we are saying, it has political implications.
Mm.
So,
dragging.
On behalf of the family of Akena, let me first reiterate this. We are extending an olive branch. Our son was killed. We know the person who killed. The conduct of the person who killed, we know. This is someone who was dismissed from Budo for boxing a teacher. He went to Ntare.
I still need to come in again. You are the lawyer. I said at the beginning of the show, you are the lawyer on the show. You know the rule on sub judice. Don't take it away. Don't take the discussion to issues that court has to inquire into.
Anyway, before Sarah comes in, when all is said and done, the point I'm saying is, we need justice for Akena.
For all.
You need justice for all. We need justice for Akena.
For all.
We need a fair trial for those who are the suspects.
Good.
But we don't want anyone to start using their influence that they fought to bring justice in Uganda.
Who is that?
You saw statements made that our forefathers were killed to bring Uganda where it is, as if someone is doing us a favor to be in Uganda.
By giving him an example, my good brother Godi Akbar was had committed a murder. He was taken to court and granted bail. He was so powerful, a member of parliament. He had so much money, but he failed to influence the court process, and at the end of the day, he was convicted. So why can't they let the Kanyamunyus also be granted bail? I know, I'm very sure they're not going to interfere with the court process, because they don't have the power, they don't have the money like the one Godi had at the end of the day. And I know what we also want in FDC, we want justice for both. We don't want a one-sided plea for justice. And that aside, I was extremely disturbed by, I'm going into the politics a bit. I saw Anywar in court. He was among the people who said, we are quitting FDC. Really, really? Does Anywar belong to FDC anymore? This is a lady who quit FDC a long time ago. By the way, so many people have left FDC, and FDC has moved on. Betty Kanye was in FDC, she quit. Did we move on? We had Tom Dime the late. We went on and on and on.
Okay.
So we as FDC are saying, as a party, we are not going to stop anybody from leaving the party as long as it's their desire. Because it's free entry, free exit. As you go, other people will come in.
Okay.
And then we'll go on and on and on and on.
I'm afraid we need to bring this part of the discussion to an end at some stage. But let me just state one or two things. One is to explain the issue of bail and how it comes in. The principle on bail is premised on the presumption of innocence of the suspect. In this case, the victim has to get justice, but even the person who is suspected must be given a fair opportunity to prove, to be proved innocent or guilty. The lawyer knows that. Odongo Otto has expressed his concerns about why you have the fears of the process being influenced.
Before
Komito. And the other question is, the suspects that are in court, if the police is still doing investigations, who knows, there might be another suspect out there that nobody knows about today. So they need to be given a fair chance at a trial. But we're going to bring this discussion to an end, and then we'll move on to have a discussion on the reshuffle in the Uganda People's Defense Forces. But I'll give you an opportunity to comment about this subject, because we'll have to bring in someone else later in the discussion. Yes, please.
The fine one of the olive branch that's being extended to our family, it's very, very welcome. I've heard from some honorables like you. We've had a discussion before, and I've told them that we were willing, first of all, to go and visit the family and express our condolences. We were willing to come in whatever that ceremony is called. We said we do not know about the Acholi culture, but we can do it in our own culture. You visit people, you express your condolences, you pay mabugo, in Uganda they call it that. But when it was tied to a confession, it's assuming Matthew is guilty. And we said, now, can we put Matthew aside and the rest of the family go to that, do some ceremony there, and Matthew has to find it from within himself. It cannot be taught. It cannot be said or demanded by parents because we were not there. We did not see it. He told us he never did it. So we shall take it that he never did it. So for the family, for you to extend a conditional, an olive branch that has some conditions that are complicated, can you consider a family meeting in, according to our culture, we also are extending before public this olive branch.
This is a very interesting argument. I think, personally, I believe there is overuse of prison in this country. A country where people have actually died in large numbers and managed to pull through. Maybe this debate should apply to many other cases. I mean, where people should be able to sit outside the modern legal system, if you may call it. And so long as it brings peace, and really, because at the end of the day, if one even got jailed for life and people are still so bitter and they are almost waiting for an opportunity to revenge,
I think there's an inherent problem with that, because...
So it's quite interesting, just
the concept of
punishment.
Matthew Kanyamunyu, Sensei Amanangwari, and any other suspect out there should have their day in court. They might have evidence that
you are assuming that court, the modern court, is the only way of solving dispute, which I think is not necessary.
Yes, because if you go there,
you are hearing from people who are personal attached to this issue, they are floating an alternative solution.
No, without a confession from the suspect, you cannot presume them guilty. And that alternative dispute suggests that they are already guilty. And
I'm arguing really beyond this case. I think it's always good to when they attest cases like this to reevaluate how do you bring harmony in society, not necessarily using the modern imprisonment-based system.
Okay, let me just take a message from someone called Gordon, who says, Charles Odonga Otto blackmailed his first time in parliament, didn't ask for justice for his sister. Let courts do their job. Gordon. How do you respond to it?
You see, well, the writings on the wall is clear. Everyone knows what happened. Akena was unfortunate to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. Even in my heart of hearts, I think when the suspect was leaving home, he did not plan that. It is just a very unfortunate incident. Well, if we are going through court, let the trial be fair. Let the trial
indeed
be fair. And if it comes into a conviction, so be it. But as Onapito said, you know, there are several
a
forms
conviction
of...
conviction or exoneration?
You know,
there are always two options.
Yeah, either way. You see, even if he's exonerated or acquitted, the cost of public opinion is still there. You saw what happened when Agaba died in a very unfortunate accident. So there is also a final court, which is not human. Actually, there was a man in Gulu called Zero saying the judiciary is to blame for Agaba's death. They should have kept him in Luzira, he would be alive. That they hurried to release him, and then he got his problem in the way he got it.
And is that the lawyer speaking?
If we are so obsessed with bail, let him get bail.
You are a political leader. You are a leader. Surely there are certain things you move above.
I'm quoting him. I'm quoting Zero.
There is a certain level of discussion that
you can engage.
I'm quoting him. I even mentioned his name.
Charles is avoiding political correctness.
But when all is said and done, for me, I'm happy that I'm seated close to the family member. I'm happy I posed for a picture with Edith Byanyima. No hard feelings.
No.
It was very deliberate. We want to pass a clear signal to the whole country that this is not a tribal issue. If we presented ourselves, or Winnie family presented themselves, and both sides sounded tribal, it's very unfortunate, because Uganda belongs to all of us.
Thank you.
And we are
That's
going to live here. Uganda belongs to all of us.
But when all is said and done, the one who killed Akena, I pray,
will pay.
If we don't get a human resolution, then God should really let justice prevail on us.
Okay, and someone says, how sure is Odonga Otto that Kanyamunyu isn't FDC, or how sure is he that Akena wasn't NRM?
You see, all those I see as trivial. But the mood, the pace we have set in this studio should transcend. Even in the next court appearance, I would expect that mood to transcend. But when all is said and done, for me, I'm happy. The state has said the investigation is complete. Let the family reapply for bail, and the trial begins. Because
no more tears.
We even, and Sarah, I think you should be respectful. When my dad died, I didn't shed tears. But to see me in court shedding tears for Akena, a nobody, because people are now calling their people from abroad, you don't come on TV and make those statements. That is disrespectful. And these are some of the things FDC anywhere.
I'm pleading
you
that we should not be erratic anymore.
Excuse me, you made statements on Honorable Beatrice Anywar. This is a senior lady who even led a demonstration to save Mabiera Forest. You should not even mention her name in your mouth.
But I've
said not your level.
She left the party.
Please, it's not your
level. Look at the fact.
So know your level. Measure your suits according to your size.
She left the party.
And Charles, next time, when you profile us in this kind of shows, you don't pick any Jack, Jill, and Jerry and you bring them for a tete-a-tete.
No, I think all of us owe each other respect on the show, at least. The fights within the FDC and elsewhere can go on before.
Fortunately, Tesla is not tribal, so I'm not supporting my tribal.
Actually, look very basically, I'm taking to Tesla. I don't know where we are done with it.
Let's wait. Last time you said we are going to protect the constituency.
We're going to take a break. Sarah and Odonga Otto belong to the Forum for Democratic Change, so they can sort their issues outside of the studio here. We will not bring that to the discussion here. Let's take a break. When we come back, we'll be looking at the reshuffle in the Uganda People's Defense Forces. Right.
Thank you.
You're still watching the Fourth Estate, and for the court processes, we hope that justice will be served to both to the victim, especially Kenneth Watmon Akena, but also that the suspects will have a fair trial. And of course, the other question is that the investigation should be thorough and not appear to conclude a case even before it's actually concluded properly. We're moving on. We're going into a discussion on possibly the widest changes in the shortest time in the Uganda People's Defense Forces. There was a statement issued on Tuesday announcing changes in the Uganda People's Defense Forces that dropped Katumba Wamala as Chief of Defense Forces and sent him to the Minister of Works, where he will be considered for a posting as the state minister. We also saw the dropping of Brigadier Muhoozi Kainerugaba, now promoted to Major General, and who has now been appointed Senior Presidential Advisor on Special Operations, as well as a whole range of other changes. Another statement issued by the military the next day, appointed a replacement to the Chief Joint Chiefs of Staff, JCOS, and then another statement that announced other changes that came out, I think, on Friday. Let's try to understand what those changes mean, why now, in the first 2 weeks of the year. We've been joined in the discussion. We have had to make one change, so we've lost the relative to the Kanyamunyus, and we've been joined by David Bukol.
Not that she has died, but you cannot say we have lost.
Yeah? No, on the show, we've changed. we haven't lost her.
Okay.
I think that's your interpretation.
Sorry.
But she's been replaced by David Bukol to discuss this. David Bukol has a long history. He once was executive director of the External Security Organization. He was a member of parliament, was a minister in this government, and has worked at the international level. The other panel remains the same. Odonga Otto is a member of parliament. He represents Haru constituency in parliament. And we have Sally Peru, who is the spokesperson of the FDC Women's League, and my colleague, Ona Peter Ekomloid.
The FDC is still there.
Pardon?
The Women's League is still there.
In FDC? Odongo is giving us insights into the FBC, which we need to investigate and discuss a lot more. Let me start with you. Let me start with Honor Peter.
Yes.
What did you make of the changes? Did they come to you as a surprise? What do they mean?
Look, what I make out of any change in the military leadership is to look at the history of Uganda. I mean, Uganda is a deeply militarized society, and the political history of this country is deeply demilitarized. So the issue of the military control has been very sensitive, and it's actually President Museveni's greatest strength, which has actually openly said is controlling the military. And at this fairly advanced age, being able to make changes, and you don't hear gunshots like has happened maybe previous in the history of the country. You must give credit to him. It really shows that after 30 years, he's still able to control the military, which most Ugandans remained fearful that maybe after him, maybe the military will not be under control. But increasingly, the transitions in the military have become so routine, and it gives one the confidence that I think a culture of accepting change within the military is maybe set in the country. And if one may say, if he can shuffle his own son, if he can. But I could also see a sort of a new crop of military leaders. Of course, there's a mix of those who have been there for a while, but you can see a new crop of leaders is taking over. Many people associate that crop with the Major General Muhoozi himself, that the kind of people have worked with him. So I think the president has effectively achieved the transition from the Bush army into the post-1986 army, and maybe truly professionalized the army. So I think it looks like a master stroke on his part.
Sarah, what did you make of the changes? Some people argue and say, Ona says the president, or as commander-in-chief, being able to make these changes without any fear to either his own hold on to power, but also the security of the country. But some people say the NRA he recruited, it was his army. The new crop that's coming in is an army that is largely credited to the mobilization and recruitment of Muhoozi Kainerugaba through the Presidential Guard Brigade initially, and now the Special Forces Command. What's your own interpretation of, what's your own reading of the changes in the army?
Of course, it's Mr. Museveni's right to reshuffle the army as the commander-in-chief. But sometimes when these kinds of things happen, you really have to think and say, why really? After what circumstances? What has driven him to this? I was very concerned as to why the reshuffle came after the Kasese incident. I was really thinking, why really? But to other people, one, we look at the composition in the reshuffle. Some of us are so sick of the regime that each time there is any reshuffle, we look at why the tribal sentiment, the tribal what, the sectarian tendencies in the reshuffles, in the promotions. That is one angle people have really looked at. Why should it be mostly people from one area that have been promoted in this reshuffle? Mostly. Okay, there are some snippets here. You get the Elweros, the Katumbas here, transferred here and there. But the one thing I noticed about the reshuffles is they're very sectarian. The promotion.
How do you mean?
Look at the names that are in the, that have been promoted in, the thing. By and large, many of them are from one region. That is one thing we are always quarreling over. We want the entire
isn't
country.
Isn't that an overgeneralization? Because if you look at the person who's been appointed deputy commander, deputy chief of defense forces, Wilson Imbadi, is from Kasese. If you're looking at the West, you're not going to. There is a multiplicity.
Now, if you look at just this from the shuffle, you don't get the picture.
Yes.
You have to look at a series of them, and you have to look at different sectors. Me, when I'm looking at this reshuffle, I don't study it alone. I look at the previous one and the previous one. Then I look at what is happening in the police. That is when I come out with a conclusion and say, these things, why are they happening this way? So that is one thing that I'm very uncomfortable about. I would have loved to see people from different regions being promoted at the equivalent, you know, pace, not others being more than the other. Now, there's this other thing that concerned me about the Kasese thing. I was extremely disappointed
to find that the man who commanded the massacre of people in Kasese has been promoted, this Elweru guy.
Mm.
What message are they trying to send? Some ordinary people are saying, are they rewarding him for the atrocities in Kasese? What is really happening? Then for a person like Katumba Wamala, of course the Baganda are crying for, but I think he has served his tenure, and many people are saying he has been demoted for a whole chief of, chief of defense forces to be relegated to a minister of state position.
Mm.
The Baganda are very uncomfortable with that. They're saying,
I haven't heard the Baganda issue statement as a group.
I'm on the ground.
I'm on the ground.
And then other people are saying...
Maybe the Baganda in FDC.
No, generally the Baganda.
Yes.
They are saying, well, this is not what really expected.
Mm.
Other tribes are getting bigger chunks, and then we are being relegated to a minister of state.
Mm.
So those are some of the sentiments that people are coming up with.
One of the sentiments that I think the military responded to on that particular change, I think the spokesperson, Paddy Ankunda, said any chief of defense forces salutes a minister, whether minister of state or cabinet minister.
Mm.
So in terms of the command structure, a minister still holds a superior position as a political leader.
These people, these ministers of state, you see quarreling all the time for being seen here and there. If you're a chief defense force, a commander, you have a budget, you control a lot of things. But what does the minister of state control?
Okay.
The minister of works of all ministries.
Let me ask the man who served with, who's worked more closely with the security agencies. Could you give us your own reading of the reshuffle?
I take five messages from this. One is the purging of the legitimate command of UPDF has been going on. And I think, like Ona seems to say, it's reaching its conclusive end now. But what I'm saying here is legitimate command. Those who have risen through the ranks, we've gone through many challenges, security challenges in the country, over 20 or so different insurgent groups since NRM came to power. And through bullet and metal, thick or thin, through those challenges, those who came through the bush, some of them were decimated by HIV/AIDS, others by other challenges that went through. But those who survived, survived. But therefore, there are those who rose through the ranks, hardened, roughened, haggard, buggered by whatever situations that we went through. And of course, they rose through the ranks through those challenges, and they matured, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
But while that process was taking place, there was a quiet, that, like for example, it's only the president's son who's allowed to recruit when he's a student in the university. People in our military, not his military, but in the national army. And then the recruitment of PGB was not subject to this other recruitment of the main force. So what do I see here? I see while those who have risen through the ranks are now seen to have served their purpose, there's another crop that is coming in. I would have no problem if that crop had a national character. Unfortunately, it was not. Because then there was a breeding of young officers from PGB. So first of all, there's purging taking place. And who's to give room to what? To these other, what I've called genetically modified officers, GMOs, in the army. Because then they are made to skip ranks. Okay, like if you see a three-week chicken weighing 21 kilograms, you must ask yourself, it must be a GMO.
Mm.
3 weeks, 21 kgs, how?
But no, there's no chicken that weighs 21 kgs.
I hear you at 3 weeks, but that's GMOs do that. GMOs, genetically modified organisms. So what am I saying here? That you are 12 years in the army and you're already a brigadier. And some people are kept in their positions as brigadiers for 12 years. Well, this one is. So when you see, like now, the deputy chief of
Defense Forces,
in 1 year, promoted three times. Is a colonel standing behind the president, Karim Mbadi, as his chief escort. And then to a brigadier in Gulu, commanding 4th Division. Hardly 3 months, is a major general, chief of general staff. How many years after is now Lieutenant General. So these GMOs, this is the point I'm making, again, arising from PGBization of the army, you transform a presidential protection unit, which was a battalion or two, into a brigade, call it PGB, and then use it as breeding grounds for officers to take control of the rest of the echelons of the army. Now, the point I'm making here is that these who have risen through the ranks under this other alternative arm called PGB, which has now been transformed to Special Forces Command, that's also another problem, because these ones have risen through, because their loyalty is to the individual, President Museveni. The second loyalty is to the army. The third loyalty to the country. Now you are taking them to the army, and you are replacing those who have loyalty to the individual, to the regime.
There is a question.
With those who have loyalty to the country first, second to the army, and third to
honorable protocol,
the individual. So the individuals can change, but because the army is loyalty to the country. So this is the problem there is when you bring your personal escorts.
Can you hold it a moment?
Yeah.
Can you hold it a moment? There. I think one is that we all respect to the whoever is watching us and the discussion we're having about the institution of the army. But the question is, how does an army transform itself? The challenges of the crop of the National Resistance Army and the challenges of the Uganda People's Defense Forces.
Let me ask you one
question. Seem to me to be different challenges, and therefore the journey to the top cannot be the same.
Of course, you are given equal chance, equal opportunity to rise and go as high as possible as your hard work and your God-given talent can take you.
Mm-hmm.
But now, if there is favoritism through the ranks, so for example, have you seen any Sabine here? Have you seen any Musoga among these mm-hmm. being promoted? Mm-hmm. Have you seen somebody from West Nile here? Have you seen?
I have seen...
Hold it a moment. Are they part of Uganda?
I have seen a Karmojong. Hold it a moment. I have seen a Karmojong promoted.
Isolated.
I have seen a Mukonjo promoted. I have seen an Etesot promoted. I have seen... I don't know whether the others are...
I've just given you a few communities, including Bakenyi. But anyway, let's...
No. Is your attempt at tribalization grounded in fact? Number two, are you giving us an analysis? Are you giving an analysis...
That there's no national character in this?
Of the changes that were made, or are you giving us sentiment?
No, I've just told you, look at the national character. The Constitution commands... These institutions must have a national character.
Mm-hmm.
These promotions you've seen, have you seen a national character in them?
Secondly,
I've just told you that when you bring your personal escorts, their loyalty is personally to you. Second to the army, three to the country. The military should be loyalty first and foremost to Uganda. Second to the military. Not to the individual running the regime, because the regime can change, let them remain still Uganda's defense force. When we have seen a military assistant of the president given to become an IGP, you know results are out.
Isn't escort a deployment?
I hear you.
Yes.
But you are brief.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what system is in this UPDF that when they come from that deployment to the mainstream, are they put on the lathe machine? You know what a lathe machine does? It does machining and turning you into the kind of spare Uganda wants you to be. Either a bolt, a screw, or whatever it is. It goes through remachining, retooling. But do you see this taking place? So these are the people who have gone to the top. When the president says, jump out, hi, sir. Sit down. How low, sir? They don't question him.
Mm.
It's not the same thing like having Katumba Wamala there. Cool. Whether through Bafasande or where. The last time the GMO I saw was deployed to command Garamba operation. Who was that? The late Kanchiriwo and Muhozi, the Tsar. What happened? 36 billion or so burnt. We even lost a MiG. There was a boy from Kumi was piloting. What happened? We got a guitar.
We got
a bed of Kony. We saw food stores burning. So this is a problem because when you rush people beyond the ranks, you promote them beyond their level of competence. So at the end of the day, when they fight, they fight like a major. They fight like a level because that's what they are.
They don't
reflect the ranks you're giving them. And so are they going to be a problem to themselves? Are they going to be a problem to the army?
Are they a problem to Uganda? So these are issues we must raise.
No, legitimate questions. I think if you're going to raise the questions fairly on this show, you need to be respectful.
That's what
so
I'm just
when you
now.
Rise, when you rise, you call people GMOs. I think that's not fair.
Well, I've given you my definition.
That expression, I think it's not fair. Number two is
an insult.
Some people actually glorify GMOs.
I haven't seen you in parliament.
Hold it a moment.
I haven't seen you present
and say based on this training, based on this operational.
Which I've just given you, Garamba operation.
No, operation experiences.
I've just given you
then
Garamba.
These promotions.
Did we send them for a guitar? Let's bring in Odongo Otto.
Let me try to bring the argument another way. Because we have people who are celebrating now that they have been promoted. Families are popping champagne. And it's a very strange country where they call your wife to put a pit on your shoulder when you get higher promotions. But what I've been thinking when I heard my colleagues talking, Ugandans don't care. Ugandans don't care whether you're a field marshal, whether you're a general. Ugandans down there are gripping with poverty. They don't care.
Mm.
They are just spectating their so-called UPDF.
They have surrendered.
They have surrendered. There is a lot of apathy in the country. And by the way, I know Mwozi quite well. I've met him in a few forums, even when he wanted to publish a book.
Mwozi David or Mwozi Kanyamunyu?
Yeah, Mwozi, the first son.
Yes.
Of course, some of the comments directed to him, like what Sarah Epero has said, is like they hate the father. So they are getting an excuse to hate the son. Now, whether you have ranks from here up to here, I posted online, a man like Iluelu, who happens to come from Teso, where Sarah comes from, for me, I will never have peaceful sleep that people were bundled on trucks in Kasese and buried in mass graves, and such an operation was commanded by Iluelu. I don't think wherever he is now, with all those ranks, he must be a very happy man. I don't think. But in relation to the comments of Fulcol, which are very hard comments, the people in the UPDF don't think the way we think. They are like a family. I experienced this when I was the chairperson organizing the burial of the late General Julius Okera.
Mm.
They see things differently. Now, the bigger question which this discussion should dispose of is, can Uganda do without the UPDF? The country is at peace with itself.
Is it?
The country, as of now, first time in since this history, it's at peace with itself.
Absolutely.
You know, this credit goes to those who lost their lives. For example, to flash coin out of Uganda, we lost 3 lieutenant colonels, 11 majors. You know, so we should give credit where it's due. But the point I want to say, yesterday I was at police. They claim when there is a big funeral, like the funeral of the late MP for DP, Honorable
Matthias.
They are now giving uniforms to privates, but with the ranks, to come and carry out the burial operation, because they say we want people from the rank of ASP and above to do the pole bearing.
Mm-hmm.
So they now give the uniform to those who are private, those who have not been promoted, to come and pose.
Is that because of absence of
no, it's because
of promoted officers,
the promotion,
officers at the rank?
There are some officers there who have been there for 9, 10, 12 years at the same rank, and no one sees them. And unfortunately, there is lobbying for ranks in Uganda.
Mm-hmm.
Charles,
there is a lot of lobbying. People even lobby.
Let me just finish this.
People lobby for ranks. I made the law, the UPDF Act. I was in parliament. It's a very strange law that has people's names at the end. Very strange law that you even mentioned the name.
Schedule 5.
And we made provisions for automatic promotion in case you don't catch the eyes of people that promote people. But you find their junior in the police, in the army, in the prison, they are very loyal to the country. No one can identify them for promotion. I posed the question, Madam Sarah posed, that the army is sectarian. Not only the army, all institutions of government, even parliament. We have over 200 MPs from one region. So we really need to redefine the country.
How is that possible?
Over 200.
How?
The traditional Mbarara.
Mm-hmm.
The traditional Mbarara has 11 MPs.
Mm-hmm.
Gulu Kitgumpade Lamuo Nuaya has 14 MPs. So only one district can outvote the whole region. So we
Gulu Kitgumpade presupposes the traditional Gulu.
Yes.
Yes. So,
but the
so
whole
if the traditional Gulu has 14 MPs and the traditional Mbarara has 11
no,
MPs.
I'm saying
yes,
the whole geographic region, the size of Belgium.
Actually.
But let me just tell this point.
I just wanted to.
Let me just
finish his point. And
so,
then
before we hurry to say the promotions were sectarian, I ever posed this question in Parliament. And they responded by saying we should also look at the history of the struggle, where it started from before it spread to other regions. But I want to say the whole government system in Uganda is sectarian, and we really need to redefine ourselves as a country.
Okay.
Look, for me, I see UPDF as a political military machinery. It's not just an army. We all know this.
It's a political party.
And NRM are fused. And it has been the stabilizing force of the NRM system.
So when Otto says,
and it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm. People are poor, they have security.
Whatever method President Museveni has used to keep evolving into what is now UPDF, if it remains the stabilizing force it has been, then to me that is something the country needs.
My question is, it's not sustainable.
I would rather, let's look at South Sudan for example. I would rather you have a foreign army in South Sudan today rather than Dinka and UN causing what they are doing. There is no point having a truly national army in terms of tribes if it is not controllable, if it is not doing the right thing.
It was not national.
I would rather even have a white army in this country if it does what people want, that is give them peace and defeat enemies. Otherwise, you can overstate the issue of tribal representation in the command. To me, the most important thing is the army doing a national duty.
The constitution.
And so far, one may have fears that after Yoweri Museveni, will it remain in control?
Mm-hmm.
But so
and
far,
it must concern us.
So far, it doesn't really. I think
it's coming to his tail end.
Many people in this town would rather
so
be happy to meet a soldier who is not from their tribe, but whom they don't fear, than meeting a soldier from your tribe who can actually kill you. And this has happened before.
Okay.
I don't mind when you earn it. You get a point.
And
when all have equal chance.
Hold it a moment. Hold it a moment. You said you had 5 points. You gave out 2.
Well, I have just told you that the purging of legitimate command. I've told you about PGBization of the army and what it means in terms of reversing loyalties. I have told you how the national character which is being violated in terms of command, and therefore it does not give me what the constitution commands that all these institutions should be. Now, when you come down to Kasese, as my number 4, you begin to see that out of Kasese brought 2 things. First of all, UPDF and its act, establishing UPDF. UPDF is built on chieftaincy. Chief of military intelligence, chief of personal administration, chief of logistics and engineering, chief of medical corps, chief of staff, chief of defense forces. These are chiefs.
But that's not
now,
the creation of the Ugandan
wait
army
a minute. I hear you. Then you smuggle in now another army within an army,
which is called
Special Forces Command.
Mm-hmm.
Is it like Africa Command of the US? Is it Pacific Command? Combined elements. And today you have that which has been developed on the side, now brought in and existing now as an army within an army. Today, all the big weaponry in Uganda is being held by UPD, by Special Forces. And it's seconding staff to brigades, to divisions, to battalion, and so on. So it has become an army within an army. It's now
the
strength
of
a division or more.
Isn't
then you come to this reshuffle.
Isn't the structure of an army?
In Kasese,
Hold it a moment.
This is how it clashes.
On this issue.
Yeah.
Every army in the world, doesn't it evolve according to the needs and structures that are developed to serve
the
act, purpose?
The act, UPDF act,
sets
up these chieftaincies.
Yes.
Okay?
What's wrong with
now,
it?
Now, the Special Forces Command.
What's wrong with the chieftaincies?
Where do you locate these Special Forces Command? But in Kasese, this is what happened.
Maybe we
Katumba Wamala,
before you go to Kasese, do you see this promotion as balanced across the board? Because
I
we should throw it back.
This is what we dismantle in Burundi.
As analysts, and as your moderator, I want to ask you the question. You look at the changes. You analyze them with what we have. You analyze them on the basis of where they are.
That's what I'm just giving you.
No. Hold it a moment. There is a difference. There is a difference, Mr. Prokol.
Especially for those
command reports to the president.
Can I make my point?
Okay.
There is a difference. There is a difference of analyzing with the facts provided and with general statements.
But listen, have I given you general statements?
I've just told you that Special Forces Command, which was under leadership of the first son, was reporting direct to the president.
Mm-hmm.
And then Chief of Defense Forces reporting to the president, the commander-in-chief. Now, in the case of Kasese, you had those statements which said Katumba Wamala had given 4 hours notice and was even arranging for trucks to go into the and take away women and children so there's no collateral damage. And then you had that Muhoozi was said to be somewhere in Hima and gave 20 minutes. The father was calling. And then
is that based on fact?
But
is that claim based on
fact? It has not been reputed. It has not been disputed.
Mm-hmm.
All that satisfies this is that now, because of the way they moved in, Katumba Wamala was forced to come and say, I was not involved.
No, but that is not true.
Because
first of all,
listen,
we
need to work
away.
But the media,
President Museveni was commanding and talking to Brigadier Iluelu on phone.
Now, where was CDF in this?
For someone to say that Muhoozi was just behind Tororo Semen
in Hima,
I think in Hima Semen.
Sorry, there's no Tororo here.
No, I think in Hima Semen.
But I want to make here is, can the army give the country that what is this Special Forces Command vis-a-vis the Chief of Defense Forces? Now, secondly, in Kasese, listen,
the question
did
before,
Katumba say he was not involved or
it.
Not?
Hold it.
Was that also trivial?
Hold it.
He said he
now,
did
the whole Chief of Defense Forces is not involved. Then who is involved?
The question
remember,
Odonga
your commander won.
Okay, let
the question Odonga also is asking you.
Now, why would our Chief of Defense Forces not be involved?
Why?
That's the question now we must ask. Then if you are not involved, then who is involved?
I'm not sure you listened to Katumba Wamala's statement to Parliament. Because I don't think he said he was not involved. He didn't put it that way. There's a member of parliament here.
I have worked with, I was a chairperson of Committee of Government Assurance, and General Katumba Wamala was a member. I even, may I use the word, deployed him in some operations. You know, they say...
I hope you appreciate I have worked with
throwing,
him.
Throwing
I've worked with all
throwing these. Water at everything would turn it into fish.
No, I'm not.
Just a second. I just said earlier that Ugandans don't care whether who is what. People are preoccupied in their own individual survival. General Katumba Wamala,
Chief, when you have added to widows and orphans in Kasese, you have to be concerned.
Wait a moment.
General Katumba Wamala being deployed in works. Let's look at the other side of it. Whether it is a demotion or not, I don't care. Because I'm with the ordinary people, I don't care who is where. But
you
are going
to
see
to
changes.
Care.
I can
you
bet
care.
You.
You have to care.
I can bet you are going to see results in works because of Katumba Wamala. This one I can't even place my right hand.
Listen,
in case you think
listen,
I'm lying.
The principal.
Can
I ask the principal here,
David? Can you make allow him to make his point and then you can respond.
So, that one I can promise you would see results. He's a very distinct
person.
Hold it, Sarah.
Will he get a better results as Minister of State than a full minister?
No, it's the material.
It is material.
Me,
it is material. It matters.
The personality
so
of the
being a general is
matters.
Doesn't mean anything. You can be a junior minister.
You know what the point I'm saying, if we can only listen to each other, is that the whole system is not fair, it's not balanced. But in the circumstance...
And when we raise it, you say
it's
a problem?
No, in the circumstance, what I would want to say is, if you hate the father, don't get a longer cut.
No.
Because for someone to come on TV and say, Muhoozi, whom I also believe has been rapidly promoted anyway, was around Hima Semen commanding the operations in Kasese.
Mm.
I think the
absence,
this statement
listen,
cannot just
listen,
cannot
the absence
like
of information.
Have to get to the root
it's,
of it.
It's up to
this
them. Listen, Chief. I am not a government spokesperson. Neither am I paid to do this. And there are those whose job it is to give that information. Mine is to analyze.
You're probing.
Listen, yes, and of course, throw the thing there and let
thank
it come
you,
out.
Thank you very much.
It's up to
thank
them.
You, thank you very much.
It's
but
up to them.
David,
it's up to them.
Your job, and my job,
is to give information.
Hold it a moment. Your job and my job is to make sure that we do not throw every rumor and innuendo out to the public, because our viewers are going to presume that because you said it on this show, then...
No.
The qualification to invite you is because you have worked in security.
Yes.
As director of external security organization, you have a better understanding of military
and
issues than some of our viewers do. And therefore, you owe it to them to tell them information
lovely.
Based on facts.
Excellent.
Yes, not on rumor.
Listen, the army we run today, how informal network, how informality mingles with formality to in decision making, what the informal does vis-a-vis formal. I had to find a way of working with the informal in order to achieve formal, whenever formal was blocked or was not producing rapid results. So I know definitely what I'm saying here. Like, for example, you are taking him now, people are being made to believe, falsely so in my view, that he's being demoted, he's being transferred, the first son, he's being transferred to be a senior presidential advisor. First of all, senior to who? 40-year-old or below? Wait a minute. That means senior. Let's double-click the word senior advisor. Now, who's advising who? President Museveni advising his son or mentoring his son, or is actually Mwosi advising the father? That's another problematic area. But let me come back to this. Let me back to
Mr.
When Pukor, you, when
Mr.
you Pukor, formalize.
Mr. Pukor, hold it a moment. Hold it a moment.
But I want to
you,
the point you
no,
asked
no, no.
me.
You were appointed a minister at 26.
Was
that a problem?
And listen, Chief.
You are 26 years old, and you were appointed a minister.
And here I am.
Was
a,
that
I am
in,
a drop of his own liquid?
In this.
And therefore,
in this. No. In this same.
Chief.
In this same government.
And that I'm advising.
Hold it a moment. Hold it a moment. In this same
and
government.
You don't see
you
any
were,
problem with that.
You were appointed a minister at 26 years. Was that a problem?
Listen, Chief. This one is in charge of special operations.
Mm-hmm.
What does special forces do?
You were a minister
in
charge of what?
What does? I was a deputy minister, a junior minister. Chief.
Yes, a junior minister.
Okay.
In charge of what?
And you grow through the ranks. By the time I became a minister of state,
mm-hmm.
from a deputy minister
mm-hmm.
to a minister of state,
mm-hmm.
by the time I moved to ESO in 96, from 87.
Mm-hmm.
So now this one, listen, Chief.
At the time you became director general of the external security organization, how old were you?
I was already beyond...
how old were you? There's a number.
You see,
it is a number.
You
can
that is why during Nazis of the
listen,
day,
listen.
Only those who are loyal.
Mm-hmm.
But listen.
No.
But I want to let you know one thing.
Yes.
That special operations folder is not double-clicked.
Mm-hmm.
Special forces do special operations. Secondly, who has taken command? Who's Nabasa? One of those recruited while he was in the university.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Lieutenant Colonel promoted to Colonel. Colonel up to Major, Lieutenant Colonel, these are field command jobs. So who is the boss of Special Forces, the real boss of Special Forces? It's still Mwosi. Honestly. He's a general in the force.
So the guy, the guy then must be a genius. He can advise the president.
And that's what
he can command Special Forces.
And that's what I'm telling you.
He's a first son. So,
this is the point I'm making. And this is the point I'm making, that Ugandans should not be hoodwinked
mm-hmm.
that he has been demoted. Now, only that this now will give him other special operations. Political special operations, intelligence special operations, military special operations. There will now be special operations. So I will not even be wrong to forecast that I will not be mistaken to see Mwosi being brought to represent UPDF in parliament, because I know the trajectory where it's going. Okay, I can plot on a graph, it's a straight line or it's a curve. At least from hindsight, I can tell
let me add this,
need to bring this
we, you wanted the 5 points.
I was just wondering why Mr. Prokol thought it was okay to rise to the rank of external director of external security organization at his age, and it's wrong for someone else to rise to that rank. To rise to a command position.
I was already beyond 40 years. I was already beyond 40 years. I was not a senior president by
then. There's been a lot of straight talk now on this show, so everything is almost on the table. It's an open secret that
people have assumed that President Museveni is grooming the Major General Muhoozi. Oh, it has been written about, it has been speculated. But let's assume that is true.
Yeah, it's a group called Why Not?
If the president is doing, is putting him in positions that clearly expose him the kind of responsibility you need, the experience you need to gain. This is what the Americans call being ready on day one to be president. I mean, do you want this country to be accidentally in the hands of someone who is not ready to be president? So I don't know why the debate. If someone is made a senior presidential advisor, which is equivalent to a minister,
okay,
and that gives him the experience to gain leadership, then that's what you need.
What do I take?
Let me take some messages from some of our viewers. Charles here is watching us. He says Muhoozi was not promoted this week. The major general rank from brigadier was handed to Muhoozi in 2015, and not this week. Thank you, Charles, for that correction. And he says, I refer to you as executive director. That position was supposed to be director general of external security organization. And they say that was a good show. Thank you, Charles, for that comment. Let me check another message. Someone says, is David Procol in order? As a former minister, one-time senior UNICEF official, and once a legislator, jobs he never rejected, many of them offered by the same appointing authority.
To UNICEF.
He says, you erratically make outlandish, uncoordinated, and irrelevant and scientific statements. If you hold deeply rooted emotional but unfactual beliefs about GMOs, when it extensively exposes, you as not knowledgeable, what is a GMO? If you served NRM as Director General of ESO, and worked very well with UPDF military officers, you then respected, and they
therefore
saluted you.
I qualify because
saluted
I know
you.
Each of them.
And you returned them. Since when were they genetically modified? I think it's a very long message from someone. Let me
then I've succeeded in provoking a discussion.
Let me take another
that's what I want. That's what I wanted.
Someone says,
know, to get the country thinking and discussing. Yeah.
Another person says, you can say anything about the UPDF, but it's undeniable. It's the most pro-people army that Uganda has ever had. Promotion or no promotion, this army has been able to fight and defeat over 26 rebel groups since 1986. Maybe the issue of promotion needs to be critically looked into. That's just an wabine.
That's the point we're saying.
Yes. Sarah, you wanted something.
Something needs to be looked at.
My biggest quarrel, my bitter quarrel,
bitter,
is towards the viewer. Why are you so surrendered? Today we're just talking about the army, but there are many sectors where there is a lot of sectarianism. And you're sitting and watching. When will you ever come up and say, enough is enough? We demand equal, you know, opportunities as Ugandans. So that's why my biggest quarrel is. So we can keep on debating, because if I gave you the list of the police, you'd cry the whole night.
Mm.
If you went to do the parastations, it's the same thing, very sectarian. So when are we waking up and saying enough is enough?
I've seen a lot of the general statements. When you subject it to actual, when Parliament summoned a list of employees of one of the institutions of government,
the URA.
Yes. Members of Parliament were shocked when they looked at the actual details.
You know what happened? In that list, the Baganda were more. But what jobs were they doing? Messengers, cleaners, and then the top jobs were going to speak rich.
Maybe
region.
That has changed.
So,
I'm being told that our time is out. We need to get up.
Well, but
one thing that we as Ugandans really have to look out for.
This is what
we're
going to do.
Surrender.
This is what we're going to do as we get out of the studio here. We'll have Odong Auto. Say one thing in closing, and then we'll come to David. We'll come to you and we'll...
I think there is a general cry for unfairness. I even raised in Parliament.
I thought a general cry for fairness.
No, for unfairness.
In
the
for
system.
Unfairness against
in
unfairness.
The whole system.
Yeah.
For example, I raised in Parliament when Edward II was still the Speaker. There is a formula in the Constitution how money should be divided and sent to districts. But when you add the total amount of money going to Western Uganda, it is more than all the amount of money going to all the other regions.
What are the figures?
No, I don't have it offered. I raised it in Parliament. Second, they put a select committee headed by the late Honorable Okecho. So the unfairness is across everywhere. People are just tolerating the regime because they seem to not to know what to do. But I think one day this country will need truth and reconciliation. We need a fresh constitutional amendment. We need to reconstitute everything in this country, taking into consideration the interests of all the tribes.
Thank you.
And when I say this, they say I'm tribalistic.
Mm.
When your people are in the key positions and you don't want me to talk about it, you must be having a problem with your head.
Okay. when is one tribal and when is not tribal? My last word is that it's very unfortunate that our army was misused in the case of Kasese, and we added into more widows because those involved in Kasese have been promoted.
Thank you.
Or maintained. Okay. And I'm saying that we added more widows, more orphans unnecessarily. I think this is not the way to make use of our army.
Okay.
And I've said, if there's anything I've said here, it's the duty of official government spokesperson to volunteer this information to citizens.
No.
Mine here is to say, there is this view, there is that view, and when I see it's moving this way, it is because of this. And please, for goodness sake, dismantling, we dismantled something which was an army within an army in Burundi.
Mr. Popol,
and I'm seeing it again.
I hear you.
I think we need to be concerned.
I think each citizen, everybody who has an opportunity to commentate on public matters, has a responsibility to speak with facts.
Which I have done.
Yeah? No, which you haven't.
I have given you Garamba operation.
No. You're kicking the can to a government.
I have given you what I came across in Burundi.
Yes.
And now we dismantle it.
He says
and now it is here.
No.
I have given you how they act based on chieftaincy. And I've questioned the fundamental principle. What is Special Forces Command vis-a-vis the chieftaincies?
Hold it a moment.
Nobody's answering.
I've said...
We don't have
a government spokesperson on the show.
But you claim to be you want to do what Ankunda said. Can you tell us what Ankunda said about this?
Yeah.
Because you now put yourself as this is what Ankunda said. Now you tell me what Ankunda said.
I have read the statements that Ankunda issued.
I hear you. So yes, why don't you allow now the spokesperson of the military to come on this point of Special Forces Command vis-a-vis the structure which is in the act?
When we have them on the show, we will do that. Okay.
And the unfairness.
Sarah, your last word?
In the promotion.
My last word, as long as you do not defy the status quo, some of us will be moving from media house to media house, you know, lamenting. It is your duty to ensure that your children that have gone to school have jobs like people from certain regions. So the only remedy that we have now is defiance. Defy the status quo, come out and say enough is enough, so that you also enjoy the cake, the national cake, like people from certain regions.
Thank you. Otherwise,
just looking on and looking on is not going to help.
Thank you. Honor.
Charles, my point is that this country's politics will remain fused with the military, and especially the transition from President Museveni to the next leader, the military will play a critical role. So if all these changes will ensure that transition will be stable, that's what the country needs.
Our time is out. Thank you very much, lady and gentlemen. I also need to thank the lady who was part of the first discussion. Thank you very much for making time for the show. Ona, Sarah, David, and Odonga Oto. Thank you very much for making time for the show. Thank you very much to you all, our viewers, for joining us tonight. And always, apologies, we're not able to take your calls, but we're able to take a few messages that came on phone. But the discussion continues on our social media platforms, the NTV Facebook account, and the Twitter account. We continue this discussion. From me, it's a good night.